main ring, onto the fairground for a musical salute, celebrating Miss Jenny Lynn's 50th concert in America, featuring the proud citizens of Washington and the American Marching Band!
Thank you. that. Let both of your feet beat onto the drum and feel your heart go right in the head. A flag in your hand.
Sir, it's not 6:15.
Damn it, Wilton, don't I even get one evening off?
Sir, Miss Linda asked me to remind you that the reception's at 7 o'clock sharp. Since President Wilmot, a stickler for punctuality.
Oh, damn, 6 months of this tour has been nothing but what? Supper with a senator, tea with a president, reception with a chief justice? Well, where do they get time to run the country? I'm telling you, Wilton, I'd give the whole tour up just to get away from them.
You don't mean that, sir.
No, I do. Old Goldsmith's been after me to buy Miss Lynn's contract again. Well, I have a good mind to give it to him. Though, it was all right when we had to turn an opera singer into a Swedish nightingale, but... Well, now all I'm getting out of that money is that bird is money. It's not enough. It's my own damn fault. Humbled myself into believing I needed some more color in my life. And she, yes, she humbled me into being respectable. A miserable state of affairs. So, I might as well be miserable being respectable with someone I love.
But I thought you, Miss Lynn.
Oh, so did I. Well, I was wrong. Well, I want you to send a wire to Mr. Goldschmidt, telling him I'll meet him in New York City day after tomorrow. And another to Mrs. Barnum, telling her that, well, if that coin comes up heads once more, well, I might just be in Bridgeport end of next week. Well, that's a waste of time, I know that. None of my female of the species humbugs ever seem to pan out. But I'm too old a dog not to try. Miserable carryings on, and in public. It's a disgrace if you ask me.
Yes, I'm muttering.
Me? Absolutely not. I'd have been politeness muttering.
Then I'll just ignore it.
I never mutter. I'd sputter, but I don't mutter. If I've got something important to say, something that matters, I don't mutter, I utter. Used to mutter. Hell, I used to have a mutter. How many times do I have to tell you, Wilton? Keep your hands out of my pants. Anyway, it's still a damn disgrace.
I bet I know what this is all about.
Oh, yeah?
The way the French ambassador smiled at me last night.
Wrong. What do I care if some weasley-looking Frenchie smiles at you? Oh, it's the way you smile at him. One of those number two, especially friendly ones.
Phineas, I'm a soprano and we
have it.
The way impresarios matter.
Wilton, the left foot goes on the left foot and the right foot goes on the right foot. So you should be.
Anyway, what's sauce for goose is sauce for gander.
What are you talking about?
The letters.
What letters?
Long ones. Daily. To a lady in Bridgeport, Connecticut. Now, if you are willing to give up these letters, I might be willing to give up my trembly smiles.
Jenny, I want you to know why. I never forget you. That's a very kind wish, Jenny. Now all I gotta do is figure out just exactly what it is I do want.
Please, we know what it is.
Such a generous deal, sir. But I'm off revising. Miss Lynn never plays bridge. don't sell me any tickets. Done?
Done.
And I still think you're beautiful. My way this time, Taylor.
Your way.
Out of the tent, away from the midway, without the benefit of Kelly Green. Buttercup yellow or cherry red? The Bridgeport Grand Opera and Pageant Company presents Mr. P.T. Barnum as he lives his life in...
Because we're all not
Nothing but a pile of broken bricks. Not to worry, not to care, so with your talent for harness, so what you wanna be in politics?
Some color into this campaign, or they're gonna beat me. Jerry, you gotta release me from my promise.
All right, Taylor. Go ahead.
What's the matter? You all right?
Yes, I just need to slow down a little.
You know what? So do I. Why don't we stop over here for a second? Isn't that an impressive place?
Oh, it's the most respectable building I've ever seen. And it belongs to you now.
Oh, Jerry. You know, standing here, looking at your smiling face in the dark, it reminds me of that first night we met in that thunderstorm. Oh, don't you were frightened, but I just wanted the lightning to strike once more so I could get another look at your face.
Oh, and I closed my eyes every time the lightning flashed, so I never did get a good look at you until we were at the altar, and by then it was too late.
What are you saying to me? Come on over here. Let's sit down.
On the steps of the city hall? It's illegal.
Well, That'll be my first act as mayor. To get a law passed that says all elected officials with beautiful wives can sit on the steps of the city hall as long as I'm in office. How's that?
Thank you very much, Mr. Barnum.
You're entirely welcome, Mrs. Barnum.
Oh, stop it, Taylor. Folks are gonna think we're foolish.
Why?
Oh, two old folks sitting on the steps of the city hall in the middle of the night, holding hands.
Who says we're old? Maybe I got a few laugh lines and one or two gray hairs, but... Cheer. You don't look a day older than the day I met you.
Oh, I thought you were through with humbugging.
22 or 3 at the most. And that's the least humbugging thing I said in my entire life.
Oh, Taylor, you're gonna be wonderful in politics. Of course, I don't expect you to say mayor for more than one term. I've already out and got my eye on a Senate seat. I'm not the state Senate either.
Chip! You're talking about Washington!
Oh, head say you can do it, Taylor!
Now, hang on a minute, Charity Barnum. Deciding to run for the U.S. Senate's nothing you toss a coin on. That takes considering, contemplating. That takes thinking about. And how come in 25 years of tossing, that coin never once came up tails?
Oh, I guess fate is just on my side, Taylor.
Well.
Oh, them and the fact that this quarter just happens to have two heads.
What are you saying to me? You stacked the deck on me, Charity Barnum?
Oh, I haven't been watching you for 25 years for nothing, Taylor.
All right. I'll run for your damn Senate. But only because I love you, and I would do anything in this entire world to make you happy. But you have humbled me good and proper this time, and I am most desperate. Most desperate. Look at that. Both sides. What are you smiling at?
Oh, everything's gonna be all right. We're quarreling again.
The colors of my life.
Mr. Barnum, may I say how sorry we are?
Month after month, he's standing there right beside me. And then, when we were right on the threshold, now, I don't want you boys to worry enough. Because during this campaign, I'm gonna be stronger than ever. We worked a long time for this nomination. And it's an election I don't plan to lose.
Mr. Barnum, I'm afraid there's been a slight postponement on your nomination.
What are you talking?
What Mr. Templeton is trying to say is, well, the party's position has changed. We're giving the nomination to Alexander Whitaker.
What are you talking about? What are you talking about? I've been barnstorming the past 6 months on the strength of the promise of that nomination.
The decision's out of our hands, Mr. Barnum. But in 4 years, you'll be a prime candidate.
Don't you understand? I don't want the nomination in 4 years. I promised somebody I'd be in Washington next January. And if I can't be there, then I don't want to be there at all. Good day, gentlemen.
But Mr. Barnum.
Get out!
Good day, Mr. Barnum.
Good day, Mr. Barnum.
me, Cherry. They took me. 6 months of making speeches. And then they take the nomination away from me. With a lie worse than any humbug I ever pulled on anybody in 35 years of fooling people. I thought I got it out of my life. But I was wrong. Because it looks as though if I don't humbug them, then they're gonna do even worse to me. Tell the truth, Cherry. Is humbugging so bad after all? Take those Rubens that came over on the Mayflower. They were humbugged with a whole new type of utopia. That turned out all right, didn't it? Huh? Yeah. And look at Thomas Jefferson and Ben Franklin back in 76. Humbugged with a whole new society of free and equal people. And that vision was strong enough to win a war, huh? Yeah. Of course, I'm not comparing live mermaids and four-headed frogs with the Declaration of Independence, but you gotta admit, somewhere way deep down there, there's gotta be a connection, huh? How do you like that, huh? Up here on a soapbox for 2 minutes, and, well, I've already convinced myself I'm first cousin with Thomas Jefferson. Darn it, Jerry. Won't that prove it? At humbugging, I'm the best there is.
The prince of humbug. Ball the dash. Fiddle, faddle, dribble, toss, twiddle, twaddle, and a bush bilge, and dodge, and double dutch, and flim flam, I am. Tommy Rot, jibber jabber, blabber buff, hocus pocus, gabble gus, scam and sham, and just a touch of white lie am I. Cock, tripe, and idle chat, Earl of Oil, Lord of Lat, Emperor of Rigmarole, that I am, bless my soul. The prince of humbug, poppycock. Piffle, waffle, patter, poke, hooey, chatterbuckle, wile, and guile, and trumpery, that's me. Don't you worry, Jerry. I'm not going back into any exhibition business, no. I gave that up a long time ago. What I was thinking, though, why don't I do a lecture? Tell the whole world about the noble art of humbug. After all, it's what I do best. It's what God gave me the gift for. So I got everything I ever had. Even you, Cherry, even you. In a world of sting and shock, this moment we spend. Down a road of ridge and rock toward Lord knows what end. Through a night as cold as space and dark as the sea. Someone's gotta think it might shoot a rocket China like tell you that someone's gonna be the prince of humbug. Tongue-in-cheek, shilly-shock, pull-the-wool, blarney, bogus, cock and bull, hoax and prank, and hanky-pang, and some skullduggery I am, and damn, I'll always be. Yeah.
P.T. Barnum, alone, unarmed, without a net, in a struggle to the finish, with destiny.
Bailey's the name, Mr. Barnum, and I'm here for my 3:30 appointment.
I'm sorry, Mr. Bailey. I've given the matter a great deal of thought, but I'm afraid the answer's no.
Mr. Barnum, I sent those plans and photographs a week ago. Didn't you get a chance to see them?
Well, I looked at your photos and, well, your menagerie looks rather good, but I've been out of the exhibition business for years now, sir. I've been doing lecture tours. To be frank with you, I don't plan on going back into it. But, of course, if
You wouldn't mind a little advice?
Yes, I wrote them.
Well, you see, sir, you gotta hook your attraction to the mood of this country. Now, it's 1880, right?
Yeah.
And with Grant in the White House, we're broadening our possibilities.
Yeah.
Widening our horizons. Mm-hmm. Now, your show's good, sir, but it's too small. You need what? 10 elephants, 20 clowns, acrobats, jugglers, bareback riders, 6 upon the high wire.
Impossible. You couldn't get all those acts into one ring.
Then you put 2 more rings on either side, sir, with a whole separate tent for sideshows. Not to mention grandstanding that you can put up and pull down to sit 2,000 people. And you've got a big train with 2 locomotives and 60 cars and enough canvas, sir, that you can put the entire Crystal Palace inside and still have enough room left over to fly a kite.
The Crystal Palace? Mr. Barnum, I hope I'm not being humbugged.
Mr. Bailey, sir! Whatever gave you that idea?
Well, I must admit, it does sound good the way you tell it, but you've got to help me!
Out of the question, sir.
I need you. The circus needs you.
No.
When the pillar dumps again, it says the call to the grip. When a stitch is in, I know there's comes a part with a rip. When the rats invade your attic, as that leave you, your ship.
Well, it's just
so follow my tip, I'm away on a trip. You're join a circus like you wanted to, where you were a kid. Climb a wall before it goes on and you
fetch
your
mind.
To lose and by and by, say so long to fail.
Joyce Head has gone and forgotten. So is the American Museum. A great white whale. My kind of humbug just disappeared. Pity. Pity. There was a sucker born every
you don't need no magic powers just to see. The over there. Half, yeah. Glory of the brain, oh, I cut them off to share.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. P.T. Barnum faces that most of all ferocious jungle beast.
He's not a general, his name's no more from the mice.
I call that trip tribute, Cherry.
Was Judge Hefley tribute too?
That was justice. I took all the years most women knock off their age and added on to hers.
Sure you're at this side. You know, that sort of bit. And then you are up behind
as far as
you
can tell.
All the sides. All the sides. Four. That's it. Four.
Can I make a suggestion? Why don't they park you in front then? This is the bottom of it.
Let go away now.
In the main ring, ladies and gentlemen, the rarest international sensation.
Where did they go?
disgrace, if you ask me. I give everything up just to get away from them. I'm telling the truth.
You don't mean that, sir.
Oh, I do. Old Goldschmidt's been after me for her contract again. Charity Barnum, what are you doing here?
My way is time.
Charity Barnum, what are you doing here?
It came up heads. And I still think you're beautiful.
Away from him, did we? Without the benefit of Kelly Green. Buttercup yellow or cherry red. Away from the Midway, without the benefit of Kelly Green. Buttercup yellow or cherry red.
The ground, don't let those daydreams spin you around. See things the way they are. You're gonna tumble if you stay home and hold on tight, living black and white.
Why is it like this all there? The walls for come for you at this sign, quickly. Then, as well as Donna, you've got Kirsty Holmes, Claire Hunt, Kelly Green, Susie River, and Emma Parnell at this sign. Time we've got to go, I've seen things far, far, far worse than this. You saw
the dancers.
Right, just the dancers, plus the ones that are already on those lists that I've done for the small parts, the wire practice. On Friday, we're doing the two stilts, John and Kelly, to finish off that one, so that one is up and ready. Now, straight after half-term, most of you know your line's reasonably well. You know, it's just an odd check on it. But what we need to do is to be totally confident by when we come back straight after half term. Right, Stuart, go to the entrance. You go.
Savage jungle beasts. Presenting first, Mr. Mr. P.T. Barnum himself, in an open bit of philosophic bungalow, Mr. Barnum!
When you duck out, you take another buck out, you run around the block, is here, run around the block, is here, run around the block, is here, do so start.
Straight after we've got rid of the scene around the museum, cuts back to Barnum and Cherry. They end up with a little altercation, but end up then doing the I like your style bit where we use the swing. I'm not going to use the swing tonight, do that. I'm just going to get them to practice just singing the song together. Not all I want to do, just stand together, sing it, get through that, and then we'll work the actual thing with the swinging. Basically, there's one bit of humour in with it. Becky's swinging, Ash is singing, they're both together quite nicely. Then Becky gets off the swing, Barnum gets off it, and he misses it. So when he actually gets onto the swing, instead of sitting on it properly, the bar is right up his crutch. And so he sings one line then, in a high voice.
Mr. P.T. Barnum, the Grand Master of the High Wire, tries for a triple somersault! And falls, which gets him plenty burned up.
All right, now.
Good Lord, they're real. Oh, what has the man done?
Very foolish thing, Cherry. Married her. A hard-headed, tough-talking, cold-eyed Connecticut... something other.
New England
lady. Who's kept my whole world from tumbling up in flames this past... Oh, that's that.
Who's kept my crazy
world going smoke these past 14 years. Happy anniversary, Cherry.
Oh, why, I might have been foolish enough to marry you, Tail. But that doesn't mean I can't count. Our anniversary isn't for another 6 months.
Not ours, the museum's. Charity Barnum, I have never humbugged you.
Mr. Barnum.
Can I let me finish your lines?
Yeah, I'm
going to
know where else.
I know.
Charity, I've never tried to humbug you. Why I've shocked you is to suggest...
Right. Listen. Charity Barnum, I have never humbugged you. While I was shocked at you even suggesting the idea. Charity Barnum, I have never humbugged you. Why, Anson? Shocked at you even suggesting the idea.
Mr. Barnum.
Not now, Mr. Scudder. Can't you see I'm lying to my wife?
Mr. Barnum.
Not now, sir. Can't you see I'm lying to my wife?
Mr. Scudder, sir, what brings you out of it? What the devil brings you out of the balloon? I have never shucked you, thinking boy. I'm shocked at you even suggesting the idea.
Well, go watch that and then we'll move on.